هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. الحمد لله. I'm so glad to see all these faces. I know today is a holiday, but at the same time today is the release of Batman versus Superman, so I'm glad you guys chose to be here instead of that what I heard was a bad movie. So for my topic today, I wanted to start with something very, very important. One of the most important factors in life, and I believe this to be a sunnah of Allah on the human creation, to be an important factor to make a person either good or bad, is companionship. Having good companions or bad companions, this is not just in the Islamic faith. We know this across the board. Parents are always worried about their children and who they be friends with, right? In terms of drugs, in terms of doing bad things, it goes the same things for Muslims. Every time we want to search for companions that are on the right path, that have a relationship with the Quran, and our parents always want us to stay away from companions or people that that will lead us astray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in multiple verses points to that, and he gives in Surah Al-An'am, in this one verse, he gives us a nice visual presentation from these verses about a man who is stuck between two sides. On one side, he's being called to guidance, and on another side, he has these friends that are pulling him away from that guidance. And he calls these, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls these friends shayateen. Shayateen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ أَنَدْعُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَنْفَعُنَا وَلَا يَضُرُّنَا وَنُرَدُّ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَانَ اللَّهِ كَالَّذِي اسْتَهْوَتْهُ الشَّيَاطِينُ فِي الْأَرْضِ حَيْرَانِ له أصحاب يدعونه إلى الهدى أتنا قل إن هدى الله هو الهدى وأمرنا لنسلم لرب العالمين. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, now keep in mind, in Surah Al-An'am is a lot of refutation. It's a lot of refutation. And Allah is telling the Prophet ﷺ, قل, tell them this, tell them that, tell them this. This is how you respond to them. Quraysh, it was getting onto their nerves about this message of Islam. So they kept saying this, this, and they, and at one point they said, stop this religion and just come follow us and the religion of our forefathers. Khalas, we've had enough. So Allah brings the response. Say to them, أَنَدْعُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, you want us to call upon others than Allah, besides Allah, that which neither benefits us nor harms us, and you want us to apostate, to return back from guidance after Allah has guided us? If that's the case, then we will be like, Allah is giving now the example, we will be like that person who has been called to guidance by his companions, but then on the other side, he's having shayateen confuse him and pull him to their side. And he ends up being confused. And then Allah says, قُلْ إِنَّ هُدَى اللَّهِ هُوَ الْهُدَى, that the guidance, the best of guidance is the guidance of Allah. So you should not be confused. So this concept of companionship, Allah points out in the Quran. Now, in our topic today, and how it relates to it, our topic today is about a particular ayah where the Prophet ﷺ has lifted a complaint to Allah. It is a very famous ayah amongst us Muslims, because just seeing the Prophet ﷺ complain, knowing his personality, it's very heavy on our hearts. And what is that complaint? The ayah in Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ya Rabb, O my Lord, my people have indeed completely abandoned this Qur'an. That is the complaint of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They have completely abandoned this Qur'an. Before we get into this verse, I don't like to just talk about the one verse. I always like to talk about the context. I always go back to the verse and we contemplate. Now, just as whoever was here last week, what was one of the reasons Allah revealed the Qur'an? Can anybody remember? One of the reasons we talk, I talk about five things, or five verses, yani, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He revealed the Qur'an. Anybody remember? I said it was my favorite one too. Aywa, that's Ahsan. Kitab anzalnahu ilayka mubarakun. Why? Liyadabbaru ayatih. So that they can contemplate upon its verses. That was a reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran. And that is what I sort of want to do today. Looking at Surah Al-Furqan and how we get to this verse. And Surah Al-Furqan, as you look at it more and more, it has an amazing theme to it. Or not amazing, more of a scary theme. But it's amazing how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts the verses together. The main theme when you look at Surah Al-Furqan was for عَاقِبَةُ التَّكْذِيبِ, the consequences of denying the truth. That is what Surah Al-Furqan talks about. The consequences of denying the truth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will find, just like we said in Surah Al-An'am, there's refutations to it. So in the beginning, Allah praises Himself, and He says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ الْفُرْقَانَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ, that it's glory be to the one who revealed the Qur'an upon his slave, لِيَكُونَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ نَذِيرًا, so that he will be as a warner to all of mankind and jinn, to all of the world. And then Allah goes and starts praising Himself. وَاتَّخَذُوا, and in the verses as He's praising Himself, وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ, and is a response to the disbelievers. وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً لَا يَخْلُقُونَ شَيْئًا وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ, and they have taken besides Him a God, a mode of worship, who neither creates, and they themselves were created by them. They were statues made by their own hands. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يَمْلِكُونَ مَوْتًا وَلَا حَيَاةً وَلَا نُشُورًا. Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to praise Himself against the disbelievers, He will always use the concept of resurrection. He says they do not own life or death or resurrection. He will always bring the concept of resurrection because that is the most exclusive quality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. The concept of putting us to death and then resurrecting us back to life. And then He goes to the discussions of the disbelievers. How did the disbelievers view the Qur'an? This is where we get to the verse of the complaint of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first thing they said, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا إِفْكٌ افْتَرَاهُ وَأَعَانَهُ عَلَيْهِ قَوْمٌ آخَرُونَ, that the disbelievers said that this Qur'an is nothing but a fabrication. That the Muhammad came up with is a fabrication that he came up with, and other groups of people helped him with it. And they had to add that. So let's put this in context. The Quraysh, it has reached their maximum with them, and they gathered all the leaders of the tribe who remained in their disbelief, and they started this group of meetings, these weekly meetings that they would do, or daily meetings, called Darun Nadwa. They would meet in secret, and they start discussing, what can we do? What has just happened in Mecca? Everybody who comes in for business, the Prophet ﷺ rushes to them, gives them da'wah, they accept Islam. Some leaders of certain tribes in Quraysh have accepted Islam. It has become problematic for Quraysh. We need to come up with something about this Qur'an. We have to come up with something about this Qur'an that will make the people turn away. What do you have? Everybody's putting in their input. Again, this is a secret meeting. So they said, ifkun. Ifk is a fabrication, something he just lied about, he just came up with. But they know that the Prophet ﷺ cannot read or write. So they said, وَأَعَانَهُ عَلَيْهِ قَوْمٌ آخَرُونَ. So other groups of people are helping him. The Jews, the Christians, they came up with a story when he went with Abu Talib to Sham. When he goes for business to Sham, he gets it from the Christian priests. He gets it from Jewish rabbis. And then they tell him what to say, and he says it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَقَدْ جَاءُوا ظُلْمًا وَزُورًا. They have come up with an unjust and a completely fabricated lie. And zur is different than ifk. Zur is a heavier type of fabrication. In Arabic today, we use zur when somebody like makes a fake passport. Say, this is tazweer, or counterfeit. Somebody makes dollar bills that he's not supposed to do. Say, this is tazweer, this is zur. It's such a lie. It's so illegal and so wrong. Allah is saying that claim they're making about the Quran is so wrong. And then they came up with another argument. وَقَالُوا أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ اكْتَدَبَهَا. I have another idea. أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ اكْتَدَبَهَا. أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ means stories of the ancient. So these people that are helping him, they're giving him stories of the past. فَهِيَ تُمْلَى عَلَيْهِ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. And it is just recited to him every day, day and night, and he just memorizes it, and then he gives da'wah to the people. Now, stories of the ancient, because they're stories of the Prophet, so they use that, asatir al-awwaleen. There was one Quraysh person, disbeliever, who kept using that term. He would always put that input, asatir al-awwaleen. It was a Nadr ibn al-Harith. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, anytime asatir al-awwaleen is mentioned in the Quran, it is associated with a Nadr ibn al-Harith. He's the one who always puts in that input. Let's just say it's stories of the ancient, stories of the old. فَيَتُمْلَ عَلَيْهِ بُكْرَةً وَصَيْهِ. So it's being helped by him. How did Allah respond to that? And you need to think about, what does this response have to do with the claim that they made? قُلْ أَنْزَلَهُ الَّذِي يَعْلَمُ السِّرَّ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Say to them, O Muhammad, that the one who revealed this, the one who revealed this is the one who knows the secrets in the heavens and the earth. Indeed, he is the most forgiving and the most merciful. What does Allah knowing the secrets of the heavens and earth have to do with their claim? That's why I put it in context. These were secret meetings. They never confronted the Prophet ﷺ with the input that they made. But Jibreel is coming to the Prophet ﷺ, telling him about what's happening in these meetings before they've even started to announce it. So now he'll go to them and say, by the way, the one who revealed this is the one who knows the secrets of the heavens and the earth. It's neither the stories of the ancient, nor is it what you guys said. This will shock the people of Qur'an. How did you know about this meeting? And we've had many instances in the seerah where the Prophet ﷺ would tell a person, you met with that guy and you decided to kill me. You plotted to kill me. Is that what you came here for? They would say, Wallahi, nobody was there. Ashhadu an la, and they would become Muslim. So Allah would end the verse by saying, إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. The doors of tawbah are always open. So indeed, he is the most forgiving, he is the most merciful. Because nobody was present then. Then that didn't work. So they shifted the conversation to who? To the messenger himself. Now the attack is right on the messenger. And anytime the people attack the messenger, they are attacking the message. Because the messenger is not but a representative of that revelation. They're actually attacking that. But they started attacking the message. The messenger. وَقَالُوا مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولُ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ فَيَكُونَ مَعَهُ نَذِيرًا. And they said, why is this messenger always walking in the markets and shopping for groceries just like any one of us? If only an angel would come down to him and be a messenger, a support for him. This is a typical response of the tribe of the messenger. They always thought, why isn't there an angel with him? Why is there a man coming to us? Why is a human being like us? This was a form of arrogance. It's a sort of arrogance. Like, if we're the leaders of the tribe, and Allah is supposed to send us a messenger, why would Allah send us one of us? And somebody who's not really a leader of a tribe? Why doesn't an angel come down? Or why doesn't Allah choose the leaders of a tribe? That was one thing. The other thing they said in that surah, is that why doesn't he have gardens? أَوْ تَكُونُ لَهُ جَنَّةٌ يَأْكُلُ مِنْهَا. Why doesn't he have gardens? This is another response, is specifically by Quraysh. In Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they said, why don't you plant us gardens and let rivers flow, right? And then get the angel, Allah and the angels to come down. And that's not enough. Why don't you get a book to come down? Why don't you go up to the ascent to the heavens and get, subhan kuntu illa basharan rasula. But they will always talk about gardens. Why? Because these people were living in Mecca. And Mecca is a dry place. There were no gardens. Unlike Medina you'll see a lot of gardens. And that's why in Mecca they were businessmen, in Medina they were farmers. Mecca was a dry place. So they're saying, if you're a prophet, a miracle for them was make a garden. Why aren't you living in gardens? How come there's not a garden? How come there's no treasure around you? Aw kanzun. Or why is there no angel walking with you? Why aren't you rich? Why aren't you wealthy? Why don't you have all this money, all this property? So Allah took that response and he says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي إِنْشَاء تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي. Oh no, before that, وَقَالَ الظَّالِمُونَ إِن تَتَّبِعُونَ is an important point. إِن تَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا رَجُلًا مَسْحُورًا. And the disbeliever said that you are following no one except a magician. This is another amazing point. Their first argument was about the Quran. That didn't work, so they shifted to the messenger, but in the end they said he's a magician. That means the words that he came with is definitely not a human's word. It is magic. They've acknowledged that. Because magic has nothing to do with living in gardens. But they said Mas'hura, so because his words were magical. So they've acknowledged it's not a human word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took that response and he says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي إِنْ شَاءَ جَعَلَ لَكَ خَيْرًا مِّنْ ذَلِكَ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكَ قُصُورًا. Again, tabarak, glory, praise be to the one whom had he willed. The scholars say, إِنْ شَاءَ أي لَوْ شَاءَ. That if he willed, if he wanted to do so, he would have made for you better than what they said, and he would have made you live in gardens. They said, why doesn't he have a garden? جَنَّةٌ يَأْكُلُ مِنْهَا. He said, Allah could have made for you gardens with rivers flowing beneath them, and he would have made you live in palaces and mansions. But he didn't do that. And this gives us another lesson when we contemplate. That in the eyes of Allah, this dunya means nothing. It means nothing. That was not the purpose of the dunya. It is not the purpose for human beings. We understand from this verse that this dunya has no value to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If He wills, He would have given you. And you will find that the prophets did not have that lifestyle of mansions, of palaces, except if it was a benefit when he was a king, like Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam. He was a king. But the majority of the prophets did not have that. Because that was not the purpose of life, and that was not the purpose of dunya. And how do we know also this dunya? It means nothing to Allah. We realize automatically this dunya means nothing to Allah when we see somebody committing a sin. When somebody commits a sin, we understand that this dunya means nothing. Why? Because this sin and nothing in this world can be done except by the permission and the decree of Allah. So when Allah allowed for sins to happen on earth, we realize that this dunya means nothing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is just a platform for testing. So Allah is saying, if He wills, He would have done that. And then He goes ahead and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes how the denial of the hour, the denial of the Qur'an, the denial of the messenger, all of that, the consequences that happens on the Day of Judgment. Then He comes back again to the Quraysh, to the argument of Quraysh. And He says, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَرْجُونَ لِقَاءَنَا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْنَا الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَوْ نَرَى رَبَّنَا. That had only the angels come down, why don't the angels come down? Or we see our Lord. And remember what I said, every tribe of the Prophet, he would ask for that. They would say, why don't angels come down with you? How come we don't see Allah? This comes out of arrogance. This comes out of pure arrogance, because they feel like a human being come to us. Why would Allah send we're higher than that Allah would send a human being. And Allah says that. When they ask for to see Allah or the angels, لَقَدْ اسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ وَعْتَوْ عُتُوًا كَبِيرًا. They have indulged into their arrogance. And they've committed so much sins. عُتُوًا كَبِيرًا. Then Allah says, you will see the angels, by the way. You ask for it, you will see the angels, but it will not be a good sign when you see that. يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَ الْمَلَائِكَ. Allah responds, you will see the angels. يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَ الْمَلَائِكَ. لَا بُشْرَى يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلْمُجْرِمِينَ. It will not be a glad tidings. It will not be good news for the disbelievers, for the criminals. وَيَقُولُونَ حِجْرًا مَحْجُورًا وَقَدِمْنَا. And they brought all of their, and Allah brought, and on that day when they do see the angels will bring all of their good deeds. So the disbelievers do have good deeds. They serve a community, they feed the homeless, they do all of this. But because of that disbelief and arrogance that they had with Allah and His Messenger, Allah is saying, we'll bring all of their deeds that they did, that they've done, and we will turn it into dust. And that will be the biggest form of regret for the disbeliever. So then we move on to that verse. So now we're on the Day of Judgment. And Allah is giving us this visual thing of what will happen on the Day of Judgment. A very scary image. يَوْمَ يَعَضُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ وَيَوْمَ يَعَضُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ. And on the day that the oppressor, that the wrongdoer will bite on both his hands. So there's an Arab form or saying that when you regret something, you start biting your finger. Even we have that. When you've done something and you're like, ah, I wish I never done that. Allah is saying they will be biting on both their hands out of regret. Showing an exaggeration of regret. And when we say an exaggeration, sirat mubalagha, it's not something that will not happen. When Allah is using exaggeration, it's something that will happen multifold than what will happen in this world. It'll be so much regret. وَيَوْمَ يَعَدُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ. And this is where we come back to good companionship that I want to tie in with how I started. What would that wrongdoer say? يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي اتَّخَذْتُ مَعَ الرَّسُولِ سَبِيلًا يَا وَيْلَتَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ فُلَانًا خَلِيلًا. Oh, how I wish I took the path of the messenger. And oh, how I wish I never took that person as my companion. With that verse that I mentioned in Surah Al-An'am, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying shayateen, He uses plural of shayateen, pulling him and confusing him to one side. In our language today, this is peer pressure. People get peer pressured because of the attractiveness of that desire and that lifestyle, and they fall into it. On the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, they will bite on both of their hands and they say, and in this world now, because they were peer pressured by these people, they go back home, they say, oh, I met this cool dude, and they know his name, they know everything about him, they know his lifestyle, yeah, he's so cool, he does this, he does that, and it's all bad things. And when they follow celebrities or figures or action figures, something like that, they know their names, they know their history, they know where they came from. They know everything about them. But on the Day of Judgment, what will they say? يَا وَيْلَتَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ فُلَانًا خَلِيلًا. How I wish I never took Fulan as a Khalil. Fulan is used to talk about a person that you forgot his name. In English, it's what's his face. That's what it's translated to English, what's his face. So actually, what the disbeliever will be saying, how I wish I never took, what's his face as a friend. In this dunya, he knew everything about him. But on the Day of Judgment, Fulan. What an idiot. And that verse specifically, generally it's revealed to anybody who falls into that, but specifically, it was revealed to two people from Quraysh who were part of Darun Nadwa. The person talking is Uqbat ibn Abi Mu'it, who was a leader in Quraysh, and the Fulan that he's talking about is Ubay ibn Khalaf. We've heard these names in the Seerah many times. Ubay ibn Khalaf and Uqbat ibn Abi Mu'it. How do you know? A lot of the Sahaba, when they would explain this verse, they would explain it by saying, يَا وَيْلَتَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ أُبَيٍّ خَلِيلًا. يعني, on the Day of Judgment, Uqbat ibn Abi Mu'it will say, how I wish I never took Ubay as a companion. But it falls general into anybody who has taken bad companions and was pressured by them. And that pressure, that peer pressure, was against the guidance, the sabil of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. On the Day of Judgment, they will fall into regret. And I wish I never took that, whatever his name is, as a companion. لَقَدْ أَضَلَّنِي عَنِ الذِّكْرِ بَعْدَ إِذْ جَاءَنِي. He has indeed, certainly, misguided me from the remembrance of Allah after it has come to me. This is the scariest part. A lot of us here were born into Muslim families. We know about Islam. We know very well about what we should do and should not do. It comes to us in the Day of Judgment as a regret when it has come to us and we've turned away from it. And then the verse ends, وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِلْإِنسَانِ خَذُولًا. خَذُولًا, very interesting word. خَذُولًا means somebody who, a friend of yours, who has left you at the time of most dire need to that friend. It's usually used by the Arabs at times of war, when they make a deal with another group, with another tribe, and they say, okay, we're going to go engage in battle with that tribe. You will join us in the army. Yes, we will join you. Battle day comes, and these people left. خَذَلَك. He has left you at the time when you need them the most. Allah is saying, those are those companions, they're shayateen. Just like He said in Surah Al-An'am. It was shayateen, they were confusing you. On the Day of Judgment, is the time they need you the most. What will shaytan say? I didn't do anything. That famous conference that shaytan will give on Jahannam, on the Day of Judgment. He's saying, I promised you, Allah kept His promise, I broke my promise. Don't blame me, blame yourselves. مَا أَنَا بِمُصْرِخِكُمْ وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُصْرِخِي. I'm not going to save you and you're not going to save me. We're doomed for life. It's خَذُولَ. He has left you at the time where you need him, the one you're like, what have you done? And the person starts to buy it on both hands. Then the verse comes. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ. After all of this, all these things, brothers and sisters, is a snowball effect. I said that in the khutbah today. All these things, it's past sins that happen. With bad companions and everything, this is what leads to the abandonment of the Qur'an. And when you look at it, even I was reading something the other day, it was saying, at the time of Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, people would wake up and they would ask themselves, who got hanged yesterday? Who got the capital punishment yesterday? Who got slaughtered yesterday? And then at the time of another Khalifa who loved music, what music can you play now? Oh, can you play the guitar now? And then at the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, how much Quran did you memorize? This was the general people. Every day they'd wake up, oh, how much juzud, how much qiyam did you do? People would go according to the environment, to the society they're living in. And typically the Khalifa would control that society. If the Khalifa was righteous, you'll find everybody else is righteous. And that is the thing with companions. When the companions are going regularly to Quran classes, you find yourself asking, how much Quran did I do yesterday? How much do I have memorized? How much do I have left? Or how much do I... But when you're when somebody associates themselves with friends that they listen to a lot of the filthy music and a lot of the filthy stuff that happens, that's what they ask them. Did I download that latest music song? Did I download this? Did I download that? Oh, I gotta get this. It's all about who we surround ourselves with. So then the messenger makes that complaint. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. How do you abandon the Qur'an? How does somebody abandon the Qur'an? And this is something one of the scholars said, this is a verse that proves to me that not taking an action is an action. Because when somebody abandons the Qur'an, he leaves and says that he's not taking an action, but that is an action in and of itself. Leaving the Qur'an in its shelf and not doing anything about it is an action in and of itself. And in Arabic, it's more stronger. اتخذ القرآن مجر. He took it as a full-time, full-time job. He took it, the Qur'an, as a form of abandonment. It becomes very awkward when you translate it to English, but in Arabic, it's very strong. They took it as a full-time job that they want to abandon the Qur'an. So now we get to Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah. Ibn al-Qayyim, he has a book called Al-Fawa'id. And in this book, he puts that verse, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. How do you abandon the Qur'an? And he says there are five categories on how you can abandon the Qur'an. Number one, هَجْرُهُ بِالْإِيمَانِ بِهِ وَالْإِصْغَاءِ إِلَيْهِ. So, you abandon the Qur'an by not believing in it, not listening to it, and not paying attention to it. Isgha is listening with attention, attentive listening. So the first one, not believing in it. I would say alhamdulillah. Everybody in this room believes in the Quran, believes the Quran to be the word of Allah. Has no doubt about that. But then when we come to listening and paying attention to it, this is where the problem comes in. He puts that as the first category. So when listening, and of course in that he explains in his book that tartil is also in it. A person reciting the Qur'an. How much Qur'an does a person recite on a daily basis? So how does somebody measure that? Listening to the Qur'an, paying attention to it, reading it. Does a person have a goal? You say to yourself, do I have a goal? In terms that every day I read a hizb. Every day I memorize a rubu'. Rubu' is about 2 pages. Every day I do a rubu' for myself. Every day I do a hizb in reading. I review 4 pages after Fajr, between Maghrib and Isha. All these goals, that is a sign of a person who has a relationship with the Quran and is not abandoning it. Not just believes in it, but listens to it, pays attention to it, and recites it. So has a schedule with it. It takes it seriously. Now again, when we listen to it, even when we listen to it in the car, do we pay attention to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Paying attention to it is treating every verse as if Allah is talking directly to us. This is a problem sometimes we built up, especially when we are born Muslim, born to a Muslim family. We read a verse, وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. Okay, so the meaning is we bring all the deeds on the day of judgment, and we turn it into dust. All these good deeds that they've done. And we turn it into dust because it wasn't done for the sake of Allah. And then I say to myself, oh, these poor kuffar and munafiqeen, man. they're going to get it bad on Yawm Al-Qiyamah. Ah, alhamdulillah, I'm safe. We're not feeling that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to us. We're feeling that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to us. When we read verses of Jahannam, oh man, these poor kuffar, they're going to get it bad. I feel bad for them. I feel sorry, but whatever. You know, it's okay. I'm safe. I'm okay. The moment a person feels safety, that's when a person is not paying attention to the Quran. Then the second level that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Ibn al-Qayyim says about abandoning the Quran is abandoning al-amalu bihi, acting in its accordance. And then he explains that and he says the person does not stop at its halal and its haram, which ties back to the paying attention to it. When Allah is saying in the Quran, this is haram, or you are allowed to do this, do we stop and look upon our actions and see that we have applied this in our lives? Or it is just words that we come through, maybe in Ramadan, we read the Quran, and we just read it flow, as long as we finish the Mus'haf, we're good. In the 30 days, khalas, we're good, and then I'll see you next year, inshallah. Put it back in the shelf. Or do we actually try to act upon it and stop at its halal and its haram? So this is a person, these are exclusive, by the way. These five categories are exclusive, meaning we might apply one and we don't apply the other one. It is falling under abandoning the Quran. So Ibn al-Qayyim, he says that even if the person recites it and doesn't act upon it, he falls under abandoning the Quran. Now, why do people not act upon it? What happened to the acting upon it? Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that we learned Iman before Quran, and then we learned Quran and it increased in our Iman. But there will come a people after us who will learn Quran before Iman. They will not stop at its words, meaning they will not act upon it. يُقِيمُونَ حُرُوفَهُ وَلَا يُقِيمُونَ حُدُودَ. They will apply every ruling when it comes to recitation, but they will not apply the rulings when it comes to its rulings and judgments. So we see that one of the things we see prevalent, one of the things we think prominent in say, people have amazing tajweed. They don't understand a single word from the Quran, but their tajweed is amazing, and they're the perfect person for taraweeh. But when it comes to acting upon it, they don't even have an idea of what the Quran is saying. And by the way, even this, yani when you ask me, this becomes problematic when they lead the prayer. Because they stop and start at verses, completely changes the meaning. Completely destroys the meaning. They tell you this one person, he's reading, he doesn't understand where to stop and where to start. And maybe this will only be for Arabs, but he says, طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى. Yani completely ruins the meaning. Is there kufr even? Right? So a person who doesn't understand, a person, he cannot act upon it. He cannot pay attention to it. So the question that I would say, or the action that I would say that has to take place, is people need to take it step by step, especially for those who do not understand Arabic. Number one, you need to learn Arabic. This is a must. This is, yani, there's no negotiation with this. No age restriction, no, I don't care how busy somebody is or something. People have to learn Arabic. Arabic is very important. We talked about last week about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it to the Arabs. And a brother, Zawla Khair, he pointed out to me that I emphasized so much on the darkness of the Arab society. I didn't emphasize on the fact that Allah chose such light, a platform with such light in terms of language and culture. I mean, with their akhlaq and their hadith. But one of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose these people is that language, the Arabic language. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose that Quran to be in that language, and therefore we need to, as a sign of love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to learn that language. And by the way, this goes for Arabs too. Don't think Arabs know Arabic, the Quran Arabic. Our dialects completely destroy things. The Qaf, don't even get me started. With yani culture, yani, people have to learn Arabic al-Fusha. The grammar, the nahu that comes with it, otherwise the tadbir of the Quran cannot work. You will find the amazing things with the Quran when you see the grammar and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses that tool in the Quran. So that's what brings the action to it. or acting upon it. The third thing that Ibn al-Qayyim mentions, and I gave the khutbah here today, and this was the tool that I used for my khutbah. It's a very important tool. He says, يَهْجُرُونَهُ بِعَدَمِ التَّحْكِيمِ بِهِ وَالتَّحَاكُمُ إِلَيْهِ. You abandon the Qur'an, a person abandons the Qur'an by not using it as a judgment or going back to it for judgment or not being judged by it. So you have a judge and you have the one being judged. He's saying the judge doesn't go back to the Qur'an to do his verdict, and the person being judged does not refer back to the Qur'an, who is the judge in that case, to get a verdict on his ruling. This is a disease in society, and that's what I was mentioning in the khutbah today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about in Surah An-Nur, a group of munafiqeen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about them, وَإِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ وَإِن يَكُنْ لَهُمُ الْحَقِّ يَأْتُوا إِلَيْهِ مُذْعِنِينَ. That a group of the hypocrites, when a judgment by Allah and His Messenger comes to them, they turn away from it. But if they have a personal advantage in that judgment, they come rushing to that judgment. Allah is saying that these people have a disease in their hearts. So not judging according to the Qur'an, not judging oneself according to the Qur'an, and this doesn't just deal with court cases or anything like that. A person in his home, how does a person raise his kids? Does he go back to the Qur'an? How does a person have akhlaq? Does he go back to the Qur'an? If a person does not go that, it especially refers to getting a verdict, fatwa shopping. If a person tries to go fatwa, try to play around with the Qur'an, play around with the rulings, or try to go to another system to get the final verdict or the final ruling, that is abandonment of the Qur'an. That is a form of abandoning the Qur'an. And he's saying these judgments have to be in the fundamentals and in the roots, the branches of those fundamentals, the usul wal furu'. So the fundamentals and the branches. And they believe, by abandoning that judgment, they believe that it doesn't benefit certainty. Its evidences are verbal, and it doesn't bring about the attainment of knowledge. There's no point in this. And this is unfortunate. This disease comes around in other formats. So they don't want to attack the Qur'an. A lot of people, yeah, and especially in our times today, Islam is so embedded into our culture. It is impossible for a person to say, oh, I don't believe in Qur'an. It's a minority of people that become atheists. But majority of people, where do they fall in? They don't want to say the Qur'an is not true. So they say, the Qur'an doesn't apply to the 21st century. Yeah, you're talking about 7th century ruling. Yeah. These are old, ancient things. These are back in the day. Right now, our systems are different. We have other systems in place, more sophisticated, more advanced. خلاص, we're living in modern times. I believe in the Qur'an, but it just doesn't fit this environment that we're in. That is a way of people. A lot of people, they use these ways, right? They want to attack the Qur'an, but they can't. They know in their culture it's not acceptable, and they won't get away with it. And people do that with the Prophet ﷺ in a very indirect way. They don't want to attack the hadith. The hadith is not an advantage to them. They don't want to attack the hadith. So who do they attack? Oh, Imam Bukhari is not an angel. It's wrong. Imam Muslim is not authentic. MashaAllah, what knowledge of hadith do you have? Ah, Imam Bukhari is a human being. Yeah, he makes mistakes like I make mistakes. Wow. This is an indirect way of attacking that hadith. But they can't. They know it's not allowed in their culture. So they say, you know, let's attack somebody else. You can't blame me for attacking Bukhari. He's not a prophet. He's not a sahabi. Yeah, he's just another person. I don't believe him. This hadith is daif. I don't buy it. And then the fourth thing that Ibn al-Qayyim mentions. Oh, and that goes into the ayah and the favorite part of why Allah revealed the Quran. Abandoning contemplating over it. Abandoning the contemplation of the Qur'an, understanding it, and knowing what the one who spoke with it intending. This is exactly the point I was saying. So knowing that when we read the Qur'an, Allah is not speaking to a third party. Allah is speaking to us directly. Allah is speaking to me. I am the one He's referring to. Right? One of the things that it becomes difficult to do, to do that contemplation, we need to understand the context. That's why I always bring the context. I never just bring one verse and talk about it. I went through the entire Surah Al-Furqan. We contemplate upon what the context is. Because we were not present at the time of revelation. The Sahaba had such deep knowledge because they were present at the time of revelation. They might not have as much hadith as Imam Bukhari. But that one hadith that they saw come out of the Prophet ﷺ's mouth, that is so deep that, you know, Imam Bukhari is just scratching the surface of that knowledge compared to their knowledge. So when it comes to revelation, they know they can contemplate it better. And there were many instances where the tabi'een, which is the next generation, the students of the Sahaba, they would say, oh, look what this person is doing. Allah says this, this, and that. They were reciting the Quran. And then the Sahabi would be present and he would say, wait. That verse was actually revealed on me and my people. And that's not what the meaning of that verse is. Let me tell you why that verse was revealed. It was much easier to contemplate when you know why that verse was revealed and know it in its proper context. In other words, Ibn al-Qayyim is saying that the person who's not abandoning the Quran, he is in full-time study of the Quran. Man, it is a full-time job. You're either reciting it, you're either learning its meanings, which requires learning Arabic, you're either contemplating upon it, you're either going back to it for judgment. This is a day-to-day thing. This is a day-to-day thing. The Quran should be with us all the time. And it also shows you how easy it is to abandon the Quran. How easy it is for us to fall in the abandonment of the Quran. We read it, we believe in it, but we're not contemplating it. We read it, we believe it, we're not understanding it. We use it as a judgment, but we're not doing this. So all these things have to apply in our lives. And then the fifth category that Ibn al-Qayyim mentions, is abandoning seeking a cure and treating oneself with it for all the sickness of the hearts and its ailments. So using it as a shifa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this Quran to be a cure. Now Ibn al-Qayyim is not saying that when we get sick, we leave all the medicine that is out there for our cure. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed means for us to cure a sickness. From it comes medicine, which is something that we use frequently, and of it comes verses that were revealed in the Quran that we rarely ever go back to. Using verses is a sort of medicine, is a type of medicine. Reading verses. When a person is sick, reading Quran is a form of shifa. Whether it is a medicine for a heart disease, that is hypocrisy and these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. O people, an admonition has come down to you from your Lord and a cure to that which is in the sudur, in the chest. Not necessarily the heart exclusively, but the entire chest. From diseases, even from sicknesses that come in. Verses that have that come down. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in Surah Al-Isra, what is the verse? قُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And we have revealed from verses from the Quran that which is a cure and a mercy for the believers. The scholars say, the more you believe, the more it will be a cure. The more you have iman, mu'mineen, the more it will be a cure and a mercy for you. So that is to the level of the person. So those are the five categories. Just to repeat them. Number one, abandoning listening to it, paying attention to it, and believing in it. Number two, abandoning acting upon it, stopping on its permissible and its impermissible. Number three, using it as a judgment, as a verdict, either going as a court case or a fatwa in our daily lives, whatever situation we're put in. And number four, abandoning contemplating upon it. Contemplating upon its meanings. And number five, abandoning seeking it as a cure. Using it as a cure and a treatment for our illness. That is five ways of abandoning the Quran. And then the next verse. That is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After he makes that complaint, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, which is another sunnah of Allah in His creation, وَكَذَٰلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ عَدُوًا مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. Yes, you are right. Your people have abandoned the Quran. But O Muhammad, this is how we have made it. For every prophet, he will have an enemy from the criminals. So what is Allah saying, the people who abandon the Quran, who are they? They are the enemy of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that sunnah is established for anybody who follows the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's path. The more you follow the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the more you will have enemies from the criminals. This concept of Islamophobia is only a sign of us being strong together. Whenever we see enemies and criticisms of Islam, it only shows us that we are closer and closer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people, the scholars say that if a da'i does not see any criticism, there's something wrong with his da'wah. If he does not see any enemies, there's something wrong with his da'wah. Because Allah has said a sunnah, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًّا مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. And such we have made, O Muhammad, for every prophet that we have sent, an enemy. Allah has created an enemy for every prophet. A group of enemies from the disbelievers. He has created them for every prophet. That means anybody who follows the path of the prophet, Allah has created special enemies for them. They could come in different forms. In any forms they come, Allah subhanahu has created it for Muslims. But alhamdulillah, it shows as a sign that the Muslims are coming together. They are really one building, one body. But we also have to understand that with that comes consequences. Enemies come. They start to creep up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made that into His sunnah. And I wanted to finish with some action items. This is just, I want everybody to go home with a commitment. With a commitment. So, we've seen that the Prophet ﷺ made a complaint, right? And anybody who has an atom's weight of love for Rasulullah ﷺ will understand that I just can't stand to see him complain. Especially about something like this, about an important message which is the Quran. So a commitment for us is to make a goal. And I've put a goal, you know, I've made for myself, I know my Quran teacher has made for us, Sheikh Hatim, he's always made it for us, to always have, at a minimum, one rubah per day to read. That is at a minimum, the lowest level. Of course, when he talks to other teachers, they tell him, 3 juz' per day, or you're not my student. 3 juz', we're talking about 60 pages. But here we're talking about a minimum. You know the star, everybody knows this star. This is a rubah, one rubah. One star to one star is a rubah. So that is about 2 pages per day. Read. I'm not saying memorize. Read every day 2 pages. Okay, let's start from Surah Al-Baqarah. We're going to start it tonight, right? Okay, we're going to start reading from Surah Al-Baqarah, 2 pages. Okay? And then, as you get to the middle of Surah Al-Baqarah, okay? So we're talking about Sayaqulu Sufaha. Let's talk about Sayaqulu Sufaha, which is the first juz'. We finished the first juz'. So that's 8 stars. I hope you guys are writing this down. 8 stars. What we're going to do is we're going to go back to it. We're going to continue. We're going to keep that 2 page consistent. But then we're going to add now half a page, go back half a page on the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. We're going to read it again with the translation. We're going to read that those same verses that we read with translation. And we're going to contemplate upon those meanings. See what those meanings mean. And then, after that, once we finish Surah Al-Baqarah, we come back and we apply it in our daily lives. What does that mean? So let's take an example. The first page of Surah Al-Baqarah, a lot of application there. Allah is talking about the believers or the muttaqeen. Who are the muttaqeen? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. So that's the belief in the heart. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. You're going to make a deal with yourself. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. I'm going to pray my 5 daily prayers in the masjid. Try the best that I can, make most of my 5 daily prayers in the masjid. And if something to do with the masjid being far from the house or anything, at the very least, Fajr and Isha. Make it to the masjid. That is a way of applying. We do not move from that page until we apply that goal. We're gonna apply it, and we're not going to move until we apply it. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And from what we have given them, they will give in sadaqah. We're not going to move until we apply, even if it's half a dollar, yakhi. Apply that verse. And it's going to be in our daily lives. And then as we see verses that has an application to it, either we contemplate upon the verses or we apply it in our daily lives. Because that's what verses are. It's either something for you to apply or something for you to contemplate about. Stories of the prophets and how he did it. This is what I want us to commit to. And try to be consistent and persistent. I ask Allah subhanahu to give us tawfiq with having this relationship with the Quran. It is yani reached a very, very important thing, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surrounded it with many dangerous, a lot of admonitions about dangerous consequences. And that's what Surah Al-Furqan is all about. The people who have let go of the Quran, abandoned the Quran, these are their consequences. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes further to say about what happened to the tribes before, the nations before, and what the consequences were for those who waged war against the prophets and the messengers of Allah. They have denied the truth when it's come to them. They have denied the truth when it has come to them. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us benefit from this lecture, and to help us benefit from the Quran and apply it in our daily lives, and to always have a strong relationship with the Quran. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم.